The following message by Pastor Dennis Clark and Dr. Jennifer Clark is brought to you by Full Stature Ministries and its supporters. For more information about Full Stature Ministries, please visit forgive123.com. That's forgive123.com.
Are you ready today? I hope so, because it's going to be deliverance. It's going to be deliverance, deliverance, and more deliverance. And I'm going to show you how to do it and how to do it more effectively. There's all different methods for doing deliverance, but guess what? It's Jesus that does the delivering, right? All right. Those watching by Ustream, I want you to pay close attention. We're going to title this message, Anointed to Win, Part 2. I believe that we're going to make this into a series, Training for Reigning, Being Conformed or Transformed, and Anointed to Win last week and Anointed to Win today. Lord willing, this will be the fourth in that series. So I want to just kind of pick up where we left. Let's pray. Father, we just thank you for this time and this season, and I believe that we've broken through a ceiling of resistance. And there's an acceleration that's coming. And as we properly align ourselves to the purposes of God, there's going to be a sudden flow, a sudden burst, an exponential sudden burst in the realm of anointing, your individual anointing. And we thank you for this in advance in Jesus' name. Last week, we finished understanding the anointing to win using David and Saul. Outlined by the three anointings of David. You all know that David was anointed three times. Anointing is to win. There's no such thing as an anointing to fail. All right? God wants you to use that anointing properly. But here's the key. At the end of 1 Samuel, I was struck by this many years ago on David's epitaph, or what David said about himself. This is someone who is healthy in their own skin. David did not say in verses 1 to 2, 1 Samuel 23, he did not say, I'm a prophet, a priest, a king, a great warrior. But instead he said, David. This is the testimony of David, the son of Jesse. I could very well say, and you could say the same thing, I'm Dennis, the son of Lloyd and Lorraine Clark. I know where I came from. David, a son of Jesse, a man raised on high. He knew that he was elevated by the Spirit of God. He was put there. He was positioned there. He didn't raise himself up, did he? No self-exaltation. He knew God raised him up for a plan and a purpose. Three, he said, I was anointed by God. He knew that the anointing, that apart from that anointing, you could accomplish nothing. And he also knew and called himself the sweet psalmist of Israel. You could paraphrase that and say he was a worshiper. He saw himself as the son of Jesse, a man lifted on high, anointed by God, a sweet psalmist of Israel. Isn't that funny? He didn't lay heavy on the title of king, prophet, priest, or warrior. He laid on the fact that it was an intimate relationship with God. And the truth that I believe is coming in its fullness to the church is that there is really not going to be any true fruitfulness without intimacy. Many people are weighing their fruit or their success or their achievements, but it's really going to be that which is birthed out of intimacy is that which is going to remain. That's the fruit that's going to remain. And so God basically just began to speak of to us this week of the Lord of the Breakthrough that we covered in the last message, Baal Perazim, to where David went to Baal Perazim and David defeated them there. And he said, the Lord has broken through my enemies like the breakthrough of water. And I believe that what it was prophesied to us at our ordination of actually all apostles, internationally known apostles came. Bishop Hammond ordained us and prophesied over Jennifer and I, but it was kind of an unusual ordination. They were all apostles, some prophets, but mostly apostolic people. And when they ordained us, they basically said that we had a breaker anointing. And the breaker anointing is that which breaks through, yes, but it makes it easier for others to follow afterwards. Do you understand that? That a breakthrough anointing opens the way, but it opens the way for more to come than just you. It's not just about you and the breaker anointing. We actually were prophesied over that we brought an acceleration to what other people pioneered, which means what other people paid the price in God for the breakthrough I entered in. But when we entered in, God said, I'm giving you a breaker anointing to bring a greater acceleration to what those other people, and it's like generation upon generation, we should be standing on the shoulders of others and hope the next generation does exceedingly abundantly above what we do. Don't you feel that's true? God's got this, it's like the barrier, the wall, the ceiling, whatever you want to call it, is broken, and like a breakthrough of water, things are going to be easier. And it's going to be easier. For us, emotional healing is as easy as breathing. I've heard many people say emotional healing is difficult and this is hard, and you know, and I'm saying it's time for the body of Christ. I believe first there will be a company of breakthrough believers. Then there will be, in time, it'll be automatic in the church and people will enjoy it. You know, historically that's happened. Martin Luther paid a price, didn't he, for justification by faith. But once that breakthrough was made available, others were able to enter into it easier. The turn of the century, Pentecost. I've said this for years. 1900s, people were still tarrying for the baptism of the Holy Spirit. Somebody brings the breakthrough, and all of a sudden, it's easier for other people. And we do have a tendency, even in our own flesh, to make it harder than it needs to be. So we want to eliminate that as well. But today's message is basically part two to being anointed to win. And I believe that we're going to enter into a time of acceleration. But today's service is going to be on deliverance, self-deliverance, because I believe that there's going to be a huge harvest, and that huge harvest is going to need individual believers so equipped that this is no longer the day of the prophet. Look, prophecy was brought back in the 80s. Come on, this is not a new thing. They're not going to go away, but what I'm saying is we shouldn't be, what, really? You know, the day of the healing evangelist was ushered in and broke through in the 50s, the 60s. You had the pastors actually pastoring the church instead of a board. Then the 70s, you had the teachers. And then in the 80s, you had the prophetic. In the 90s, you had the apostles. But I'm going to tell you, this is the day of the priesthood of the believer and the day of the saints. This is about you now. Amen. Take up your bed and walk, right? This is no longer the day of spectator. This is the day of participator. We do it in a very small way here by opening up the mic. We do it in a small way by he that has a psalm, a hymn, a spiritual song. But the point is, 99% of your life is outside. 99% of your life is supposed to be in the arena of the home, right? School, employment, church, all of the areas that God's got. Now, here was the key in this series, and I want to go back to it, is I saw the key. David was a warrior, but he wasn't angry. He that rules his own spirit is greater than the mighty. Do you believe that? And he who has no rule over his spirit is like a city broken down where the enemy can run rampant all over you, push you around. But 2 Samuel 22, that whole chapter, and I'm not going to read it all, but verses 1 through 51 reveals the warrior, but it reveals the heart was clean. Listen to this. David spoke to the Lord the words of this song on the day that the Lord delivered him from the hand of his enemies, from the hand of Saul. The Lord is my rock, my fortress, my deliverer, the God of my strength in whom I will trust, my shield, my horn of my salvation. So he shall save me from my enemies. He is my stronghold, my refuge, my Savior. You save me from violence. When waves of death surround me, the floods of ungodliness made me afraid. The sorrows of hell surrounded me. The snares of death confronted me. In my distress, I called upon the Lord and cried out to my God. He heard my voice from the temple, and it entered his ears. Many are the afflictions of the righteous, but God delivers them out of them all. He sent from above. He took me. He drew me out of many waters. He delivered from my strong enemy, from those who hated me, for they were too strong for me. Say that back to me. For they were too strong for me. We're not to fight this against flesh and blood, but principalities and powers. And you've got to know how to keep your hands clean. I hear the Lord saying that the success of the anointing and the anointing to win that David had was basically because he knew how to keep his heart right. Amen. He was a warrior without anger. But on the other hand, if you want to be a peacemaker, you've got to learn how to wage war properly. So it says here, with the merciful, you will show yourself merciful. With the blameless man, you will show yourself blameless. To the pure, you will show yourself pure. To the devious, you will show yourself shrewd. You will say, humble people, but your eyes are on the haughty, that you may bring them down. For you are my lamp, O Lord. You shall enlighten my darkness. For by you I can run through a troop and leap over a wall. You have also given me the shield of your salvation. Your gentleness has made me great. Your gentleness has made me great. And this portion of scripture was what God worked on me when I had a nemesis who just disagreed with everything I taught, because I brought the dance, the prophetic, in 1980 into the church. And you know what that was like in the beginning, right? 1980, all right, in the late 70s. And they were doing I was doing everything that this cult researcher didn't like, I was doing. I had friends in the faith camp. I had friends in the prophetic camp. I had friends in the kingdom camp. I had pastor friends in all of these camps, and he didn't like any of them. And I was in his backyard for 13 years. He just hammered away until at 13 years, all of a sudden, my spiritual father and Dr. George Benenet and Dr. David Miner were invited to speak to 200 pastors. And out of the 200 pastors, they called me up and they said, what's that pastor's name right there? And my spiritual father, that's Dennis. Okay, Dennis, come up. I came up in the midst of 200 pastors from the entire Pittsburgh region. And basically, he said, God given me a word, and I had, I'll make the story shorter, but anyway, to make a long story short, it nailed the situation to a T, even to the numbers. He said, the Lord's showing us that there is a Korah, a Dathan, and an Abiram that have come against you, a balding one. One whose relationship has grown cold and he's turned his guns upon the church. And he has chosen you to persecute. But know this day, it is over. From this day forward, it's a new day. There is a breakthrough. Now he said something about the name Dathan, Abiram, and Korah. There's something that means a balding one. Or he used the term a balding one. And all 200 pastors started chuckling. And he didn't know why. The so-called cult researcher was 20-some years old and prematurely bald. And he wore a wig that was extremely noticeable that it was a hairpiece. And no names were mentioned. These were two pastors invited to speak, and they just said, a balding one has come against you. One whose relationship has grown cold and his desire to turn the guns on the church, to clean up the church, and it's not his job. I mean, they nailed it really quite specifically. Next thing you know, I got a phone call. Why did you mention my name in front of 200 pastors? I was receiving a prophetic word. I didn't name anybody. If the shoe fits, wear it, right? And from that day forward, I found out that everything ceased. His ministry pretty much ceased. But it was literally a prophetic word that said something has broken. And from that time forward, it was done. All right? So, many are the afflictions of the righteous, but God delivers them out of them all. And you know where I could identify with David? Is those, for me as a young pastor, those were the worst of years, but they were the best of years. Because I learned what I believed, why I believed it, and quite frankly, it went from feeling like you're kicked in the gut to eventually hurt to eventually nothing at all except a free flow of love flowing out toward him and toward the situation. And it was just like a beautiful flow of love that showed that there is a strengthening in the inner man that God brings to pass if you learn how to guard your heart with all diligence. You have to learn how to guard your heart. Guard your heart. The only wall, and we're going to do some deliverance prayers today. The only legitimate wall in your heart is peace. Let the peace of God guard your heart and your mind. When you think about it, all those obstructions you put up because of people, places, and things, those are flesh, those are carnal, and they will not protect you. And matter of fact, they will limit the Holy One of Israel within you. So, let's begin. We're going to loosen the soil first, though, okay? Because the goal is basically we're going to remove barriers that hold us back. I believe that God's making ready a people prepared for what's about to come. And one of the things that we learned from David, no matter how much warfare there was going on, no matter how much victory there was still the need to keep your heart clean. So the purpose is who may ascend the hill of the Lord? He who has what? Clean hands and a pure heart. Who has not lifted up his soul to idolatry. That's anything that's more important than God. If there's anything more important than God, it's going to come out today, right? You're going to get rid of it. I don't hear a lot of amens. I do a little wobble heads here, but that's okay. The preparation for ascent. If we're going to move up. Listen to this. Obadiah verse 17 and 21. On Mount Zion there shall be deliverance, and there shall be holiness. The house of Jacob shall possess their possessions. Then, this is exciting to me. Deliverers shall come to Mount Zion to judge the mountains of Esau, and the kingdom shall be the Lord's. So there is going to be deliverance in Zion, and there's going to be deliverers coming to Zion. Which one do you want to be? You want to get your deliverance first so that you can be a deliverer? I believe there's a breaker anointing that's going to take place in your life, and things are going to become easier. And self-deliverance is going to be, someday, it's going to be commonplace. Right now, I believe God's raising up a company to replicate, to duplicate. Because I believe that what was prophesied to us, that basically we basically got a breakthrough and pioneered an acceleration where other people's labored and pioneered and got breakthroughs. And I believe it's going to continue until it's commonplace. So, in preparation for this ascent, that there shall be deliverance in Zion and holiness, and there shall be deliverers that'll come to Mount Zion to judge, to discern, to make a distinction. Back years ago, how many know William Morford's One New Man Bible? Well, he was in our church plant in Columbia, South Carolina, which eventually moved to Charlotte. But back then, he was in our church, and he was at that time working on the One New Man Bible. And he made lots of interesting discoveries, but one had just penetrated Jennifer and I and has never left. He made one discovery in the translation, and it's my three favorite verses now. Of course, all the verses are favorite, and that'll change next week. I'll have a different favorite. But these three are exceptional. They're the three double I ams in Isaiah. And these three double I ams, I felt, summed up what we want to see a major breakthrough. Breakthrough the ceiling of difficulty in the church at large, and have these three scriptures become a supernatural manifestation in us to the church, first in us, then to the church. First in us, then to the church. Here's the three verses. Isaiah 43:11, Isaiah 43:25, Isaiah 51:12. And I looked at our ministry, I even looked at our books. Our books are basically a summation of these elements and breaking them down into granular. Scripture number one is, I am, I am. And by the way, this I am is different than the other 30 I ams in the Bible. How about that? And I said, how are they different? This is what got me excited. He said, the other ones are ani, ani. This one is Anohi, Anohi. It's like God is saying, I am, I am. I've got an attitude about this, and I can do this, and nobody else can do this. I'm the only one that can do this. Isn't that the implication? I am your deliverer, and there's none that can deliver but me. So much for many ways to God, right? I am your Savior, and no one else can do that. A better translation would be deliverer. Savior, deliverer. I am your deliverer, and nobody can deliver you but me. Secondly, I am, and I've got an attitude about this, and I am the only one that can do this. I am your forgiver, is what we would say. I am he who blots out your transgressions for my own namesake. How about that? What do we teach? Where's the forgiver live? In you. He's the one that forgives the sin. You yield and you allow him to flow. I am your deliverer. Self-deliverance. Where's the deliverer at? Point to the deliverer right now, real quick. Oh, good. There, nobody pointed to heaven. Whew. Boy, you'd have to stay after church. But believe it or not, the vast majority will. All right, you're not the vast majority. You're going to be a company that you're going to teach people. The deliverer lives in you. He lives in you. Quit running around looking for people. People can't deliver you. They can be used of the deliverer, right? When you're hurting, you do whatever you want to do if you're hurting, okay? But I want to teach you how to do it yourself when there's nobody around. I am your forgiver, the one that blots out your transgressions for my own sake, for my own sake, and I will not remember your sin. Then the last one, Isaiah 51:12. I am the one who comforts you. Everything else is a false comfort. We've got to stop settling for false comforts. Everything else is a substitute. It's my people have forsaken me, the fountain, and they've hewn for themselves substitutes. Something to appease you. The day of appeasement is over. The day of looking to the Lord for the solution is nigh. Now. This is the day of salvation. Today, now is the acceptable time. All right, so we're going to loosen the ground a little bit. I am your deliverer, and he lives in you. All right, we're going to teach you how to make it more effective. I can do old school deliverance and get some results, but I think we can fine tune it by showing you how to help yourself in the process so that you're not relying only on somebody doing deliverance on you. Okay? There's a value to it, but there's also a weakness in it. First of all, if you've been around for a long time, you should be in an intimate enough relationship with God to do self-deliverance on yourself. You're not a newbie, all right? Newbies usually get real upset now. I thought you were going to do it for me. No, we're going to teach you how to let Jesus in you do it, all right? So we're going to loosen the soil. Step number one, there's going to be five elements just to loosen up the soil before we start doing ministry. One, fear, doubt, and unbelief. We're gonna receive forgiveness right now. The new creation always believes God and his word, but there's a part of you that has a tendency not to listen. The new creation loves God and loves you. That's the real you. The real you loves God, loves his word. Do you agree? The real you loves God, loves his word. Fear, doubt, and unbelief is when all of a sudden over a period of time, you begin to see that You got wounded in the church. You were disappointed in the church. Oh, and don't tell me that doesn't exist, because most of the church doesn't go to church. They got disappointed, discouraged, or wounded in the church. If you're watching by Ustream and you're one of those, this is your day of being set free. This is a day of deliverance. Now is the acceptable time. Today is the day of your salvation, really. Because hope deferred makes the heart sick. And God wants a healthy bride without spot or wrinkle. He wants her to be clean, clean hands and a pure heart. Who's going to ascend the hill of the Lord? He that has clean hands. And quite frankly, we talked about, you know, Saul being a spear thower. You know, he threw it at David. Did you notice David didn't throw the spear back? There's a lot of wounded people out there that quit going to church. But quite frankly, you're upset with some spear thrower, pastor or leader or family member or church member, when in reality, right now, you're throwing those spears right back. You become what you hold hostility toward. You become like what you hate. So you've been hurt. We've all been hurt. And quite frankly, if a pastor like myself, if you got hurt, you probably got hurt in the church. The world, they're just acting like worldly people. You shouldn't get hurt by the worldly people, should you? They're just acting like worldly people are supposed to act. But fear, doubt, and unbelief. And see, God didn't distance himself when you got wounded, disappointed, or discouraged, did you? What happens? Very subtly, you distance yourself from him and the church. You treat God the way you treat people. You treat people the way you treat God. Don't say you love God, but those people you can't stand. If you are distant from the church, if you're distant from the people, you are distant from God. You will feel sincere, but you can't live like that. God doesn't have a plan B. Did you know that? That church, no matter what condition it's in, is his only plan. He doesn't have another system for you. It's his church. Sometimes the wool of sheep can heal a shepherd. Sometimes a shepherd can heal a wounded sheep. It's all a question of you opening up your heart and removing offenses. We're going to get cleaned up today from fear, doubt, and unbelief. What does fear, doubt, and unbelief do? It's a barrier and limits you and limits the Holy One in you, your deliverer, your forgiver, your healer. He paid all that price to set you free and remove those barriers. I look at Elijah, great victory on Mount Carmel, called down fire, killed the prophets of Baal. He prayed and ended the drought. He outran Ahab's chariot. I don't know what the purpose was, but that was pretty cool. But Elijah ran from Jezebel. And it's so funny, all of a sudden, this powerful man of God, this can happen, shows you it can happen to anybody, huh? All of a sudden, he's going, I wish I would die. I didn't believe him, though, because if he really wanted to die, he wouldn't have ran from Jezebel. He let her kill him. But anyway, you know how we talk. You know how we talk when we get hit, right? It's enough now, Lord. Take my life, for I am no better than my father's. Oh, well. Let's pray for that one now. Fear, doubt, and unbelief. We're going to loosen the soil. Father, if there's any way that I've allowed fear, doubt, and unbelief in any way, shape, or form, I want the Holy Spirit to rise up in me and show me that, because I receive forgiveness for barriers. Any kind of a wall other than the peace of God is ungodly, unnecessary. I receive forgiveness for taking in fear. And what the Spirit of the Lord is going to do to the body of Christ, he's going to start saying, look, instead of being fearful and saying I'm addicted to it, panic attacks, low-grade anxiety all the time. That means you are addicted to fear as a believer, and God says, I want to turn that into where you are allergic to fear. Are you ready for that? I receive forgiveness for being so addicted to fear, something God never gave me. The new creation me doesn't want it. I receive forgiveness for taking in fear. I want to be allergic to fear, that when I even feel fear come upon me, I go, I know who you are, but I'm not taking you in. Amen. I'm not taking you in. Uh-uh. I hear you knocking, but you can't come in. I feel your presence, but I'm not going to absorb you. Peace is guarding my heart and my mind. Oh, I feel you, but you can't come in. And out of my belly flows a river of loving, anointed intercession. Out of my belly flows the issues of life. Yes. All right. If you want to get defeated, though, just keep praying. and let your faith decrease little by little. Lower your expectations. That's what some people do. I just don't expect anymore for anything to happen. Change your theology. Well, God really doesn't really want me to blah, 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 right? Most people, their experience will tailor their theology rather than pressing through that glass ceiling and getting into what God has for you. You become bitter, mad at God. You get depressed. You give up. Those are guarantees of defeat. You quench the spirit. Step one in the school of the spirit, when God was saying, I'm not letting you go to Bible school right now. I'm going to teach you the school of the spirit. The first thing he did was when you close my eyes and you feel my presence, I don't want you to grieve, quench, or resist me. That magnified that it was a person on the inside, not an it. It wasn't an anointing. It was him. And you treat a person different than you treat a thing or an it, don't you? And he wanted honor. And so God's basically saying, you got to die to God is punishing me. That's how some people change their theology. Nothing ever happens to me. God only heals a few people. I must not be included. Some have even said the dispensation for healing is past. It's not for today. The truth is there's at least 1,000 healing scriptures in the Bible. So let's get serious here. All right? Let's pray through some of these things. First of all, Father, fear, doubt, and unbelief. We're going to do it in a general way right now. I receive forgiveness for fear, doubt, and unbelief. I know that I've kind of drifted and distanced myself. I receive forgiveness for any distance in Jesus' name. All right? Feel clean? Just on that? Now we're going to go to the second element to loosen up the soil, murmuring and complaining. I know no one in here does that, but in case you do, and for the benefit of those watching by Ustream, murmuring and complaining. Your complaints are not against people like you think. They're against God. You're offending God with your complaining. I don't care what you're complaining about. You're ultimately offending God. Exodus 16, verse 8. Your complaints are not against us, but against the Lord. Receive forgiveness right now. Forgive those you blamed, including God, God, self, and others. Right now, I receive forgiveness for complaining. It's not about who's right or who's wrong at this point. It's about complaining. I receive forgiveness. I even release my judgment against God that it's somehow his fault. And then the third element, and this is where we're going to see success in deliverance. If you talk to any deliverance ministry and you say, why did not everybody get delivered, or why did so-and-so not get delivered, the most common thing was their will. You can't violate somebody's will very effectively. You can push back the powers of darkness around somebody, but it might very well come back, right? Using your authority. How about if we teach them how to tap into the deliverer in them and your prayers come into a place of agreement? God wants your will, but he works from the inside out. Satan wants your will, but he works from the outside. So let's yield to the deliverer in us and say, my will, not my will, but your will be done. I'm yielding my will. Surrender's going to be a sweet. I'm going to be allergic to anything other than surrendering to the Lordship of Jesus. Oh, phew. The anointing just changed in the room. I just think that right now, that willingness, you know what? Thank you, Lord. I want to break that spirit that really it was like what the rich young ruler had to deal with. The rich young ruler, he basically said he came running. You think he was enthusiastic? How about the word the young people use, passion? Although I think it needs clarified a lot of times. Passion. One came running, knelt before him, asked Jesus, good teacher, what shall I do that I might inherit eternal life? Jesus said to him, why do you call me good? No one is good but God. But just one, God. You know the commandments. Do not commit adultery, do not murder, do not steal, do not bear false witness, honor your mother and father. And he answered and said to him, Teacher, all of these things I've done. I've done all of these things from the time I was a youth. Then Jesus looked at him, loved him, and said to him, One thing you lack. Go your way, sell whatever you have, and give to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven. And come, take up your cross and follow me. But he was sad at this word and went away sorrowful, for he had great possessions. It wasn't the possessions as much as the unwillingness to let it go. He had a will problem. So I don't care that he knew the scriptures from the time he was a child. I don't care that he was full of passion and enthusiasm. When it came time to the will, being totally into the hands, totally subordinate to the lordship of Jesus, he was troubled and sad. Sad means that it's taking the place of the supernatural peace of God that is indicative of the rule of God. So in other words, he can't release. How many feel like you have a will problem? Don't raise your hand. We're going to deal with that. Those of you watching by Ustream, I want to deal with your will, because you want to see success in getting set free. You want to see success in getting healed. You've got to understand it's not what somebody does to you. It requires a willingness on your heart for the lordship of Jesus to rise up. You have to want to. You have to not just want to, you're going to have to yield and surrender. How many know your will is down here? I'm not talking about up here, because that sincerity can be up here. You can be sincerely wrong, but down here is where you yield in the heart. And you let. This is where Jesus lives. This is where the deliverer rises up. So I yield my will right now. Yield my will. And if you're watching by Ustream and you're sitting in a chair, just that I could fall. I'm so yielded and surrendered that I could fall through this chair if it wasn't holding me up. I yield my will. I don't want to be like the rich young ruler. And then there's, remember John 5? One who had an infirmity for 38 years, when Jesus said that, saw him lying there and knew that he was already had been in that condition a long time, he said, Do you want to be made well? Some people have made a living out of being sickly dependent. You want people to pay attention to your condition, but you're just setting yourself up for failure. Let's receive forgiveness for any lack of a real want to in making my physical body healed, my emotions whole, and the lordship of Jesus preeminent. I receive forgiveness in Jesus' name. Oh, and here's another one. When we start and planted churches in my lifetime, I start out with the number one message. We're here to teach you how to deal with your issues and die to your agendas. Let's die to some agendas. You think anybody might have an agenda? What's an agenda? I want what I want, and I'm going to find a way to get it. Absalom. Good example. He didn't really care about the people. What did he want? He wanted to rise to, he had an agenda. Let's pray that through. Father, right now, if there's any agendas in my life that are not the guidance of you, they're not the plans and the purposes that were predestined before the foundation of the earth, it's something of my own concoction, it's something that I want, it's a goal, doesn't point to true north, it doesn't point to the perfect will of God, but it's actually a distraction. I receive forgiveness and die to any agenda. We're still just loosening the soil. Holy Spirit, bring agendas to their mind, because agendas are tricky. Agendas can be a good thing. Agendas could be not sin in and of themselves. The sin is when you've exalted it above God. How about the prodigal son? Lust of the flesh. Do you realize that prodigal, basically what he told his father is, I wish you were dead. Give me my portion now. I can't wait around for my inheritance. And I just want to be an extravagant, lustful demonstration of happy living. And I want it in all the wrong ways. We loosen up the soil a little bit?
Oh, yeah.
All right. Now we're going to get down to the nitty-gritty. Those watching by Ustream, we're going to begin to move. I want you to do it this way. This is our way to hopefully get better results. I want you to pay attention, not figuring anything out in your head. I want you to pay attention to your spirit, to the gut. And it's even better if you close your eyes. I'm going to name a list of areas, and I want you to feel your gut knows truth from error, clean from unclean, right? Right from wrong. Your gut knows things your head doesn't know. I want you to listen to your gut as I go through these. And then anything that you feel caused you to lose your peace, you've got something that needs to set you free. You've got something that needs to go. You've got something that's a barrier between you and your destiny. Are you ready? Close your eyes. And I want you to feel. I don't want you to think. I want you to feel in your spirit if there is a bearing witness, good or bad. If it's good, it will remain peaceful. If it needs attention, it will disrupt the peace, no matter how subtle. And I don't believe you have to have cultural manifestations. I don't believe you've got to throw up and do all of that kind of stuff. All of those things are more cultural than anything else. You have an anointing within, and you can tell when something's coming up against it. And you can get a release on it by the deliverer and the forgiver that lives in you. Are you ready? First one, shame. Condemnation. Inferiority. Pride. Guilt. Insecurity. Fear. Intimidation. Timidity. Anger. Resentment. Rage. Addictions. Bondages. Lust. Insomnia. Incest. Molestation. Rape. Immorality. Pornography. Hurt. Rejection. Depression. Loneliness. Now, how many felt a resonance on something? And here's what we're going to do. First of all, you go say, God, where did I open up to that? Close your eyes. Where did I open up to that? When? What was the circumstance where that happened? Nod your head when the first person or situation that comes to mind. When did that first open up? We're going to close that door. Got something? Then I receive forgiveness for taking that in, knowingly or unknowingly, and I release forgiveness out of my belly to whosoever. I don't want to give, my battle cry is going to be no ground. I'm giving no place to the enemy. I'm going to close the door on him. And I have that capacity because it's my will. And my will and the door is only open to God. I close the door through forgiveness and repentance on any one of those areas. Okay? If you're watching by Ustream, the area pops up. Question number one, God, where did that get started in my life? I receive forgiveness for opening the door to it, knowingly or unknowingly. If that's got a demonic hitchhiker to it, I receive forgiveness and I command it to go. Now, commanding it to go is allowing the deliverer in you to rise up with healing in his wing. Let the deliverer rise up in you and say, I command that to go in Jesus' name. Say that out loud. I command that to go in Jesus' name. Now, after you said it, did you have peace? Nod your head. Because God won't lie to you. If he doesn't put peace on something, that's going to come back. Well, you can hear words again that come back, but it doesn't penetrate. You could say, I feel you, but you can't come in. I'm allergic to you now. I hear you knocking, but you can't come in. Are you ready? How many have more than one? Nod your head. Okay, good. I want you to come up now. I want to pray for those that basically have something specific to come up. All right? Those of you watching by Ustream, let's do it again. I receive forgiveness for opening the door. I receive forgiveness. I repent and receive forgiveness for taking it in. That closes the door. And I allow the deliverer to rise up. You have no part of me now. You have no permission. You have no legal ground in me. My deliverer just rose up and cast you out. Jesus, the deliverer who lives on the inside of me, rose up and cast it out in Jesus' name. Amen. Okay, I want some people to come up. I want some specificity. Come on. Victoria, what came up? This is for everybody to learn. You're going to be a demonstration.
It was fear. My father was really violent.
Okay, close your eyes. That's enough. They don't want to.
Okay.
Okay. This was fear of the father. When you picture a father, he was a violent man. You feel the, what's the emotion?
I'm just really afraid.
Okay. I receive forgiveness for taking in that fear. And any spirit of murder, anger, wrath, or malice that's come down the line, I command it broken. There it is. It just broke off. Before I was done talking, it broke off. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. You shut the door, and you've got authority to get it removed, okay? What was yours? Okay. Then right there. Feel the feeling. All right. I receive forgiveness for any uncleanness. That's the way you tell in your spirit. It either feels clean or unclean. I receive. There you go. I close the door. I know when that came in, you already dealt with that part. God's saying you already dealt with that part. So now what we're going to do is I let the deliverer rise up and I cast that thing off. To no longer harass, in Jesus' name. You've got nothing in me. You have nothing in me. I've closed the door to that, in Jesus' name. Now, here's something else I want. Can you tell something left? Can you tell something left? I want you to have your own subjective experience to where you can perceive a freedom. Okay? Person or situation, what was it? Intimidation,
mm-hmm.
Form of fear.
Yeah.
Feel the feeling. Is it there now?
Yeah.
Oh, that feels more like hurt, but okay. All right. I receive forgiveness for taking it in.
Yes.
That's your personal response. I release forgiveness. Very good. There's a nice flow. And now I command that the deliverer rise up and no more harassment in that area in Jesus' name. Anything external, you have no ground. Can you tell? Can you tell it's different?
Oh, yes.
Oh, yes. I want, see, this is different. It's not what I tell you. It's what you have your own know-so. That's the difference. All right? And what's yours?
Anger and hurt at my son.
Anger and hurt with the son. All right. Do forgiveness, and let's close the door to anger and hurt. Any Any demonic harassment? Is this a repetitive thing? Yeah. Okay, I receive forgiveness. I close the door. I release forgiveness to him. Now let the deliverer rise up and say, I am impervious to anger. I will not take it in. That's not me. The real me loves God and loves his word. Now let the deliverer in you rise up and push it out. It's the Jesus in you doing it. There you go. Whoa. We're not giving the believers enough chance to let the Jesus in them do the work. They're still relying on me doing it, right? That's going to take a while to break that habit, isn't it? That's okay. We're getting there. Okay. Can you come down a little bit? You can go back to your seats. Get Mandy?
It was inferiority with my oldest brother.
Okay. Close your eyes. Receive forgiveness for taking in inferiority. It's a spirit of fear. I receive forgiveness. I release forgiveness to him. I'm closing that door. And now, the deliverer in me rises up and cleanses me, and I cast that away, that all of that intimidation, all that spirit of fear, and not to come back. The deliverer rises up in you. I think you did it while I was saying it. Mm-hmm. Can you tell?
Yeah, I feel there's still like a little.
Okay, tentacles. Then stay with the little. What else is there? I receive forgiveness. I release forgiveness. Now you, out of your own mouth, command it to go in Jesus' name. You got the smile on your face. That's good enough. That's it. One thing, when there's a victory, it should end in peace of some sort. It should end in the fruit of the Spirit. If you truly get ministry, you don't feel worse after. You should feel peace. And in these cases, you could feel their spirit was either peace, joy, and in Mandy's case, it was joy, or thanksgiving. It puts a smile on your face. You ever see somebody get saved and they automatically smile? That's an outward expression of what actually transpired on the inside. Okay, what was yours?
It was insomnia.
Okay, insomnia.
I began to feel like.
Do you know where it started?
I think, yeah.
Okay, then receive forgiveness for opening that door way back then. I closed that door to insomnia. Oh, now we want the Spirit to go. We want the Spirit to go in Jesus' name. I allow the deliverer in me to rise up and cast that thing off once and for all in Jesus' name. Jennifer's got an anointing for this. Let her do it. Come on up here. Just bless her with that in Jesus' name. We command that spirit of insomnia. It has no place in me. The new creation me is allergic to you. My Lord gives this beloved sleep in Jesus' name. Oh, she's going to sleep now. You can't sleep now. You got to wait till you go home. All right. Anybody else? Christy.
Mine's rage.
Okay.
That's betrayal.
All right. So, Father, right now, in the name of Jesus, I want you, do you know where it came in at?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. You closed that door already?
I am now.
Okay. Where the rage came in. Rage is always demonic. It's not just an emotion. I receive forgiveness. I release forgiveness to whosoever, right? You know how to do it. Okay? It feels like peace. The door is closed. God won't put peace on a lie. If you feel peace, the door is closed, all right? Now, that spirit of rage, we command it to come out. Now you command it to come out. I command you to go, spirit of rage. And you don't have to have the name accurate. You have its nature. The nature always matches the name. Rage is good enough. If in doubt, call it unclean. They're all unclean. Thank you, Lord. I yield My will to the deliverer. There you go. I don't want to be telling you. You tell me. How does it feel when you say, I command you to go? I command you, rage, to go. Tell me what you're hearing in your head or what you're feeling.
I felt easy.
It's easy?
Yeah.
Okay, that's it. That's another way. One of the ways you can tell you've got victory is when it's easier to obey than to not. When it's easier to do right than to listen to that voice, you're free. That doesn't mean the voice doesn't come. It just means you're free from the power of that voice. And here's the key before we close. This is the most important key. Too many people argue with the voice up here, even when it's demonic. You go to the power source and you strip it of its power, then you can renounce that voice. Don't argue with the voice. Don't quote scriptures to the voice. Deal with the power behind that voice and nullify that voice. Do you know what I mean by that? The emotion is the power behind even a demonic voice. Cleanse yourself from the emotion. You take away its power, and the voice then has to come down. Every voice that you hear in your head, picture two, we teach this in the modules, right? Two lines of authority. Every word you hear in your head has two lines of authority going into your head. One is the actual words, the other is the power behind the word. So if I want to nullify that word, I don't try to talk myself out of it. I go to the power source and nullify the power behind that word. If I heard, Dennis, you're a bad golfer. I don't like to golf. I went one time. It was boring. If I heard that in my head, there's no power behind it. But if I heard in my head, Dennis, you're a bad husband, and it could get in there and then bother you, I would have to deal with the part that bothered me, not the word. All words have an authority behind them, good or evil. Deal with the authority behind the word. It's the opposite of the way many of us learned it, because we learned to confess, to decree, to declare. All of that is valid, but I'm telling you to start paying attention to the source behind the declaration. But even I've even heard TV preachers say the same thing. Without the Holy Spirit, you can't do anything anyway. So it's not just the words, it's what's on the words. All right? Are you free? Do we have a healthy church? Where's the deliverer? Quick, point to the deliverer. Oh, good. You're getting so good at this. Now multiply that out and ask him. First of all, Jesus, the Messiah in you, where is he? Point real quick. All right, now you're supposed to be doing this to your friends. You already know the answers. Where's the forgiver? Point quick. Where's the deliverer? Point quick. Oh, yeah. Where's your will? Uh-huh. Oh, do we have any visitors for first-time visitors? Okay. Those are the only ones that are going to get it wrong. All right? So let's pray. Father, seal this work for the days ahead. The glass ceiling is broken and the barriers and the walls are being removed. I'm going to be fully equipped in the days ahead for a huge harvest, and I'm going to be able to teach them how to rely upon the Jesus in them as both their forgiver, their deliverer, their savior. They're going to know that he's the true comforter, and unless they go to him in an intimate relationship, even their gifts and everything can cause them to distance themselves from him. Don't let your gifts distance you from God. Cause your closeness to God to bring the kind of fruitfulness that will remain. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen.
You've been listening to Pastor Dennis Clark and Dr. Jennifer Clark of Full Stature Ministries at forgive123.com. Full Stature Ministries reserve all copyright protections under applicable law. Our copyright policy is available at our website, forgive123.com. For more information about Full Stature Ministries and additional life-transforming materials, please visit forgive123.com.
Did you know that we have an online school available? Hi, I'm Pastor Jason Clark. We invite you to join our international community of almost 1,000 students currently enrolled in a school like no other. Team Embassy equips believers to live in the Spirit by giving them the how-to tools for wholeness, intimacy with God, and living the abundant life Jesus promised us. You will learn how to heal emotional pain quickly and completely. You'll discover amazing keys to tap into the fruit of the Spirit and practice the presence of God as a lifestyle. Exciting courses available include the 60-Day Challenge, Self-Deliverance, Healing Rejection, Codependency, Intimate Prayer, The Functions of the Human Spirit, and many, many more. It's formatted so that you can take it with you on all your mobile devices. Sign up today at training.teamembassy.com. Be transformed. Become all God created you to be. You will never be the same.